Okay, so I guess this is where we, well, this is not where we stopped. We were talking about distributed detection, and we had talked about all these things. And this is where we were, I think. So the idea there is that if you think of your problem as the problem of spectrum sensing, and if you think of this as being the phenomenon, being the primary user, whether it is active or not, and these are your secondaries or cognitive radios trying to monitor or observe, and then you they send their decisions, yes, it is available or it's not available, and then you come here, and then this is where the decision is made that yes, it is available or not available, and then you can move on. So that's basically distributed detection. When I started looking into it, there were no cognitive radios, but the paradigm, the formulation fits very nicely. I mean, basically it is that problem that I've been studying for a few years, and I won't mention how many have already done that. But okay, so now the fact is, so we are now talking about this fusion rules is this part here, and what it means is that at this central place you are getting some P sub ones, which is the output of the local sensor in your parallel fusion topology. And thing is, what should we do here? Okay, so then one can look at it in terms of, one can have hard decision fusion or soft decision fusion. So hard decision fusion, in that what will, I guess it's defined down below here, but the basically what happens is that the sensor or your cognitive radio, it processes all the information that it gets and then comes up with something which is yes or no. So it's a binary kind of thing, short fade, but anyway, hopefully it will come back and it won't last for too long. So it basically sends a binary decision, yes or no, and then the fusion center, so hard means it's binary, and the fusion center is faced with the problem of incoming zeros and ones, and then how do you combine them and come up with the final yes or no. And I did mention majority rule could be something that one can use, but that need not be optimum. And somebody did, I guess at the end, ask, give me an example where majority rule will not be optimum, and I think I tried to answer that, so then you'll see that. The other thing is soft decision fusion. So in that case, the sensors or your cognitive radios, they are not doing zeros and ones or binary decisions, but they are sending some information, and it could actually range from the raw data. I mean, that is soft also. So if one sends raw data, then that is soft. But if you, in the context of detection theory, if you send likelihood ratio, we know what likelihood ratio is, we can send that. So that is a compressed amount of information that you send, and that is also soft decision. Or you take even, let's say, likelihood ratio, and then you quantize it into a few bits. That is soft decision. So basically, hard, we are just, we don't need to distinguish, but we are distinguishing it that you send, get hard zero or one or something else, which is, hopefully it is compressed because you want to minimize or reduce the amount of data transmission. So I guess let's just read. So soft values, likelihood or this, FC combines these soft values to make an optimal decision. The decision is again zero or one, yes or no. So finally, availability or not unavailability. That's the decision. Performance, robust, complexity is higher. And this is based on all the received DI values and low complexity and poor performance. Poor performance, what that means is that if you had all the data, the performance will be better. So poor performance does not mean poor performance. It means that by design, you compressed your huge amount of data that you collected into a binary thing, zero or one. So that is heavy data compression. So there was information loss. And so that's what this refers to, that there is information loss, and that is something you cannot recover. Once you have compressed it, then you cannot get it back. So that's basically what poor performance means, that you compress, and that's what is causing your poor, so-called poor performance. In soft decision fusion, I think I've said all of these things, but let me read it out. So local sensors forward, either the observations completely, so those would be raw data that you will send, and then the fusion center will get your vector of observations. So you get all the information that comes in, and then it's like a centralized detection problem. It's just that you stack all the data that came in, you put it all, and then process that and do your likelihood ratios or whatever. So we have the tools that we looked at earlier yesterday, and those tools can be used to solve the detection problem. Now these you are, in fact, these were mentioned yesterday as in folks that have taken digital and or wireless communication courses, this is what you see, this is diversity. So if you have diversity combining schemes, so I mean maximal ratio combining or selection combining, so these are sort of diversity things. Maximal ratio combining, I think there was a question here. So basically you estimate the signal to noise ratio on the link, and then you, if it is a better quality link, then you give more weight. If it is a lower quality link, then you give lower weight, which is what, I mean, the fusion rule that you will see. It will be that if the person or the sensor reporting that their data, you have more confidence in them, then you give them more weight, etc. That is intuitive. I mean, if you know that I'm going to get poor quality data, then you don't want to weigh them equally or weigh them relatively high. So that, I mean, so that's the maximal ratio. Selection combining is that using some methodology. So in this case, what it says is that if observations that pass some sort of an SNR threshold, if you say that SNR is high, basically they are more informative, then you use them. So that's selection combining. Now, if you do quantized data from local sensors, so there are many things that one can do. You can actually, observation itself, you can try to compress using some sort of quantizer. Essentially what you are doing is you are sending, instead of one bit, you are sending multiple bits. And you can obtain them in any manner that you want. It could be that you take the likelihood ratio, likelihood values, and then in the case of binary, you would have done single threshold, yes or no. You can have three thresholds, so that you can have four possible outcomes, and you send that in two bits, etc. So that's basically what this is saying, that you map your observations, or you take all the data that a sensor gets, and that data is somehow reduced to a few bits. And some possible ways are mentioned here, like compute the likelihood ratio, then quantize that and send that. And the this thing, I guess, will come in shortly, that the optimal decision rule at the fusion center depends on the BD and PF of the individual sensors. And this, again, looking ahead or intuitively, when we say that it depends upon the confidence that you have, the likely quality of the decision, so how do we quantify the quality of the detector in terms of PD and PF? So that's what will happen. So you will see when we get to it shortly, that you have the weights will be related to the performance metrics for individual detectors. So it's coming. Oh, it's here, or almost here, not yet. So hard decision fusion techniques, I mean, so voting rule, I guess, would be that choose the hypothesis. So these are, again, your DIs coming in, and I'm talking about binaries. But it can be extended, it can be, so if you go to my book, I have a book 20 years ago on this distributed detection and so on. So there is a section on soft decisions, there is a section on this, that, and the other. So let me just focus on the binary case. So what it is saying is that if L, so there are K decisions coming, if L or more are saying that yes, then you say a yes. So L out of K decision rule or fusion rule is nothing but saying that if L or more people say yes, then you say a yes. Now, if you translate that into your voting or in your political thing or whatever, then remember, like in parliament or wherever, there are some situations where simple majority works, there are some situations you have to have two-thirds or whatever. So this accounts for that kind of thing that I don't know. I think there are some bills or some things that require more than a simple majority. I'm not really familiar with all the political things and how bills are passed and so on. But I know that there are different things. So L out of K, so if there were 10 censors and you need a two-thirds majority, then whatever, 7 or more have to say yes. So it's that kind of thing. Other things, I mean, I don't know. I don't know, many of you are faculty members, but the system here is different. In the US, in academia, a person gets tenure at a university, and getting tenure means that's the permanent job, essentially. Here, I think you first couple of years you are on ad hoc or probation, and then it becomes permanent. But it is done, I think, by the number of years that you have worked. It's not by performance, is it? I don't know how it gets converted from the ad hoc or probationary period to permanent. How is it done? It's just you have been there for 2 years physically and you get permanent job, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so it is performance is included. So let's just say that in the US, it is 6 years of probationary period at a university. And during sixth year, one is evaluated. And evaluation is pretty tough. So I have tenure, by the way, so, which happened many, many decades ago. But the thing is, so sixth year, the evaluation takes place. And the evaluation is based on your teaching. So there are three categories. One is your teaching, the other is scholarship, and the third is service. So an individual who is going up for tenure, I mean, like sixth year, they have to look, make a decision, yes or no. So binary decision. If the person gets tenure, then they are appointed for seventh year onwards, and that means that they are permanent. If they don't, then seventh year is their terminal year, last year at that place, and then they have 1 year to find a new job. So as far as tenure goes, the reason I brought it up, the voting thing comes in. So there, teaching, I mean, you have to have adequate record of teaching, and teaching is not just going to the classroom and so on. You need to show something innovative in teaching itself, some new methodology, something new that you did, you wrote a textbook or something. I mean, you created something in teaching. It's not just, as I said, going to the classroom, reading out of your notes. So that's not. Scholarship includes papers published and research grants that you brought in and grad students that you worked with, and etc. So that's your scholarship portfolio. And service is service to the university, which means committee work and so on, service to the profession. So in your, let's say if IEEE is your professional society, then did you serve on program committees? Did you become an associate editor of a journal? Those kinds of things. And then also service to the community. So meaning that if you serve on Red Cross, Board of Red Cross or something. I'm just trying to think of some other, some NGO, for example. Then that will count as service to the community. So all of these things are counted. So this was just a digression, but coming back, when the person is going up for tenure, then the entire tenured faculty, they vote on the candidate. So it's not just head of the department or some sneaky way that it gets done. So everybody gets involved in it. They vote, and 2/3 is required. So I was just getting to 2/3, and the story was just to support that 2/3. So it's not a simple majority. So there are situations, some constitutional amendments or something, they require more than a majority. Okay, back here. Now, the AND rule is basically says that everybody has to say yes. Then you say a yes. OR rule is that at least one person says a yes, then you say it's a yes globally. And the detection rate and the false alarm rate are given by these. And so what it is saying is, so D sub I, so summation of D sub I is the sum of all the decisions that came in. So, and if that is greater than L, so L out of K, so if it is greater than L, so the probability that you decided an H1, this is the rule, given that H1 was true, that's the probability of detection. Same thing here, probability of false alarm is that you decide H1 when H0 was true. So this is how one can calculate this. And anyway, so this is just, I mean, voting or L out of K, but in a minute I'll talk about how to involve PD and PF and find the optimal fusion rule. And here, again, this is more relevant for identical sensors. So you, there are no weights and so on. For some reason, I went on and I described the tenure system in the US. I don't know why, but they seem to, they're looking at it, oh, okay, it's not just the head of the department, in some middle of the night signing away the
things. So it'll come handy probably.
Yeah. So anyway, the point is that, I mean, it's a very open system and everybody participates. It's a participatory system rather than what I just said. That.
So I missed that whole description. So maybe you can do it. I can do it separately.
So as I was saying that.
So just a high level question, what is the fraction or what is the probability, let's say, with which a person gets tenure once given a job? Is there any such number?
There is no such number.
There is no such
number. So there is no such number. And things, and it's a dynamic process in the sense that some places are there. Bar is much higher, some places it is lower. Yeah, let's put it that way. 50 years ago, one of my colleagues.
By the way, you're on video, I think.
Oh, okay. And I did describe all of that, and I talked about sneaky head of the departments and so on. I'll back it up, yes. So I have to be very careful now. And there is no way to erase it. I go back.
No.
No, I'm just. I didn't say anything. But the bar.
I know. I'm just.
The bar is could be different. But 50 years ago, one of my faculty, I mean colleagues, he had been there for 7th or 8th year or something. And as I said, 6 years is the magic number. So if you are appointed for 7th year. Without a terminal appointment, then that means you have tenure. So 8th or 9th year, he just sends a note to the vice chancellor. The fact that I'm still here means I have tenure, right? Mm-hmm. So it was that kind of thing. But now
so
it's.
Why is that number 6? Is there any significance to that?
I don't know. That's just everybody follows that. Okay. And I think it is something that comes out of maybe whoever came up with it, that 6 years is a sufficient time to prove yourself. And it is AAUP, American Association of University Professors. So that is, it's not a union, but it is a group that sort of deals with the welfare of faculty members, whether people are getting paid okay or not. But again, there is no governmental negotiation and strikes and UGCs and all that kind. That again, I'm on camera, I know that. But there is no such thing. AAUP is simply the body that is there, but no, it doesn't have the authority to negotiate. One other thing I can say, because we're just going off in different directions, some universities and faculty members are unionized. So there it's
nice. Yeah.
Wheeling and dealing and negotiations and stuff. Okay, so I guess the local decision rules, we needed to, in the picture that you saw, the sensor comes up with the D sub I, yes or no, and at the fusion center, the global decision is 0 and 1. And this is kind of interesting. You might not realize that just the very fact that the fusion center is getting some binary inputs, just binary, and it will become much more if it was Emory data, for instance. Binary data, then the fusion center is nothing but a logical function with k binary inputs and one binary output. So all of you who did your whatever switching theory, switching circuits, Boolean algebra, whatever. So if you recall that the so number of fusion rules actually is 2 to the 2 to the k in this case. And if so, let me go to this, and it actually shows that for two inputs there are 16 possible fusion rules. So 2 to the 2 to the k grows very rapidly. So the complexity will grow higher, and if you have to search over many things. And so here basically there are, if there are two binary inputs, two people reporting, you could have 0, 0, 0, 1, etc. And the fusion rules that I talked about earlier, this one, F sub 2, is the AND fusion rule, where you get, if both of them are saying 1, then you have a 1. Otherwise, the output, the global decision is 0. This one is the OR fusion rule, where if one or more are saying yes, then it is a yes. This one is the feel-good fusion rule. No matter what people say, it's a yes. And this is Varshney's fusion rule, where no matter what you say, the answer is no. So I mean, there are different kinds of fusion rules and so on. So maybe this is a tough parent and this is a very easygoing parent. But the real thing should be somewhere here, right? Okay, so I guess a little bit more on distributed detection, I mean, how to design things. I think I should speed up. So Bayes risk, the total cost. So this risk we had talked about in the sense of single detectors. Now we have multiple detectors and so on. So this is the making the global decision, trying to, so this is the cost. If you recall, there was something similar that I had in for the single, I mean the regular detection thing. And so this is what we want to minimize ultimately, and what we need to do is to design the rules at the sensors, that means, so the rules there and the fusion rules, like the ones that I talked about. And the computational complexity of the fusion rule, as we saw, it increases exponentially, 2 to the 2 to the k, so it becomes very high. And when the local observations are conditionally independent, given a hypothesis, then the optimal fusion rule is given by this, which is the PDF of the vector D that is coming in given edge 1 and D given edge 0. When you do that, then because of independence, it is the product of it, the marginal, so PDF of each DI given edge 1 and edge 0, compare that to a threshold. This is what we had yesterday. So this is actually solving that same problem for the fusion center. The input is a vector of binary random variables. Here is the likelihood ratio, and comparing that to a threshold. And if your, I guess, let me see. So here we had PDI given H1. So we can convert that basically to a NAP rule. Let's just say that log of likelihood ratio, this thing, one can express that, I mean, there is a little bit of detail here, but in the in order to speed up, one can say that the log of likelihood ratio can be expressed in this manner. So what we have is log of pi 1 divided by pi 0. These were prior probabilities of the two hypotheses. If we assume that they are equal, then this will become zero. So then what we have is log of PDI divided by DFI, if the DI, the incoming decision, was 1, and if the incoming decision was minus 1, then this is the weight. So these are nothing but the weights assigned to individual decisions that are coming in. And as I said, PDI and PFI, they characterize the quality of the detector, the quality of the detector, because that is described in terms of PDs and PFs. So intuitively, the decisions need to be weighted, and they are weighted. So it makes sense, and it is intuitive that this be done. And then, and then you compare this to a threshold, and that's your, the fusion rule. So it is a weighted fusion rule. You take all the people who are saying once, assign them this weight, and then all the people who are saying minus 1 or 0, then assign this weight, and compare this to a threshold. That's the optimum rule, and it's very simple now that it's done, but we just formulated the problem and did it. It's a very short paper, but it probably got several hundred, or maybe it's not 1,000 citations, but a lot of citations. So basically, Zainuddin Shire, it's not chair, Shire with a little dots. So he basically, it was part of his thesis, and he did other stuff. And then when the sensors are identical, then this decision rule simplifies to L out of K, the one that we were looking at. Okay, so all right. So this is the optimal fusion rule. I think I'll skip this. So basically, we were talking about it yesterday, about being asynchronous things. So what this is saying is that in the previous thing, it was assumed that all the detectors report their decisions or their data at the same time. But if they don't, then it is asynchronous decisions. And these asynchronous decisions then, there is an additional sense of uncertainty. And that uncertainty was taken into account not by us, but by one of my friends, Moshe Khan and his group, and they said that the probability of the ith sensor making k tau I decisions, so it is, they observe over a period, 0 to tau, and then they send however many decisions they have made. So it's, so they will send a vector of decisions. And that is modeled, how many are in there is modeled by a Poisson distribution, and then the optimal fusion rule, the one that we had, by using this additional uncertainty comes down to this. So let's, I think one final thing in this part, and I think I want to spend a couple of minutes on this. So one question arises. So when we had, we have, let's say in this case, multiple sensors or multiple CRs reporting their decisions. And we always think about their performance, or questions may arise that if we keep increasing the number of sensors, number of cognitive radios, what will be the impact on performance? So that we call asymptotic performance or limiting performance. And these kinds of things are very important, because you need to know what is achievable, what kinds of things. Of course, in practice, you will have finite number of things. But if you were able to do that, keep increasing, then what will be the result? So that, it's a part of, you can say, information theory, part of decision theory, or something in between. So actually, Stein's lemma that is stated there, that's part of information theory texts. I know there are at least a few people in here. So Kovar and Thomas, their information theory book, this will come under some chapter, I don't remember which chapter, but there is a chapter where there is a relationship between detection theory and information theory. And so that, I think, this, I mean,
is it a newer edition or the same old edition?
This was even in the old edition. And this work, I think there was one paper in the mid 70s by Dick Behart, 75 or so, and he got awards or something, where he was relating information theory to and detection theory. But the point is here that basically, if D is a random vector having k iid components under both hypotheses, the optimal detector results in an error probability that obeys this. There are two expressions here. This one is more in the Neyman-Pearson sense because we are talking about probability of false alarm, and this is more in terms of probability of error, so Bayesian sense, average probability of error. So what basically this is saying is that that the probability of false alarm for a fixed PD, it decays exponentially, and the rate at which it decays is given by this quantity, which is called the pullback Leibler divergence or distance. So KL distance or KL divergence is something that provides the rate at which the probability of, in this case, false alarm will decay as a function of when you keep adding more and more. So as K is the number of components, number of sensors, or it would be if you have, you're taking more and more samples, as you take more and more samples, in the limit, the probability of, so in the Neyman-Pearson thing, PF goes down to zero. The important thing is at what rate. And so in many cases, and in a lot of the work that the security part, this is what we have been using, this pullback-Leibler distance or divergence. And we use it as a surrogate for error performance, or I mean probability of error. Like for system design, we use KL divergence instead of the actual probability of false alarm or something. And the reason, once again, is that tractability. This is, I will then show you in a minute, but it's there, so the definition. So it is easier to calculate pullback-Leibler divergence rather than calculating or finding your probability of false alarm and so on in many cases. So I guess what I'm saying is that in the design, in the things that we will talk about the rest of today, you will see this will feature quite prominently. And again, I mean, I just want to get this point across that it is a surrogate. So if we cannot minimize the probability of error or false alarm, then the rate at which it goes to zero, that also is an important thing. So we hope that trying to minimize this is also minimizing the probability of error. So this is, so that's the justification. Something happened very recently. We had submitted a paper to transactions for signal processing, and we used this, and we didn't explain because it is standard knowledge in the community that KL divergence its role. But the three reviewers, they had no idea. So they said, what is KL divergence? Why do you do it? And I said, come on, DSP reviewers, you ought to know this better. But anyway, so then we had to write a tutorial on what I just told you. We had to write that, and hopefully they will learn and listen to us and say, yes, it makes sense. But they totally, I mean, missed it. I mean, meaning
that's what we observe a lot of times. I mean, sometimes we just miss the...
No, I don't know what happened. I mean, because the reviewers should have known. I mean, it is... and one other thing I guess I should mention, KL divergence is a member of a broader class of things. They're called Ali-Silvey distance measures. So in case you are interested in research and so on, there are many types of divergences, F divergence and many things. So there is a broader class going beyond KL divergence, there is a broader class, and so it's important. Now the second thing, this C is the Chernoff information. So there are two things, so this is the Chernoff information and this is used here. So again, the probability of error goes to 0 as k goes to infinity, and this is the rate. So both Chernoff and KL divergence, they are important, and they both specify how rapidly the probability of error or probability of false alarm goes to 0 as you increase the number of sensors or size of data. And then here is the definition. So you need to know the basically the probability distributions under H1 and H0, and that's what they are. Okay, so just summarizing, I think detection is the primary task in cognitive radios after sensing the wireless channel. A cognitive radio could employ any of the techniques, Bayesian, Neyman, Pearson, or what have you. The Neyman-Pearson framework is employed when the false alarm rate has to be upper bounded. So mainly if there is a bound on the probability of false alarm, then you usually put this. Energy detector, which is strictly not optimum, it is a good one to use. It is low complexity and for low power for devices. Matched filter, we talked about that. Sequential detection can be employed when it is known that the primary users transmit whatever at a slower rate than the sensing frequency of the CR. So basically, if you are collecting samples as you go, then if the data is coming sequentially, you can do that. MIMO cognitive radios use multiple receive antennas, so vector model is useful. Practical CR systems contain a network of local CRs or sensors. So this is a cooperative network of spectrum sensors. And what I just described, that is, it's a distributed detection problem. Various fusion rules were discussed. To improve distributed detection, one can do sensor selection, which is that you don't need to get data from everyone, maybe selected few. Then the question is how to select which ones and so on. So there are, I mean, I don't know if in the detection context too much work has been done. Estimation context, a lot of work has been done.
In sensor selection.
Sensor selection. So I don't know, that's something you can write down and see if that's something you want to pursue in a detection scenario. But this
You have worked in detection, right? For sensor.
Yeah, but we didn't look at sensor selection problems there. So just maybe one paper, but that's something that.
So it's between sensoring and sensor selection. Is there a difference, or is there similar? Or
there
similar?
Is. We can talk about it later. Okay. And compressed sensing is something that hopefully we'll have time to talk about it. So here again, I mean, you want to. Sample fewer sensors rather than everyone. So, and this is to be done, I mean, if the signals are sparse. And then FC makes the decision on the basis of what comes in. And so if there are malicious nodes, then what happens? And that will be the remaining part of today. So security is an important aspect in cooperative spectrum sensing. The most of this material, I think, poor. The distributed detection part was from my book. Vantries also probably we took some material, but a lot of the terminology came from, or I mean the notations from Vince Poor's book. So these are the references. That's fine. I thought there was something else that came to my mind, but I have forgotten it. I'm like flowing water. Once it is gone, it's gone. Question?
Sir, I'm a doubt.
Let me take the second question first. So does the asymptotic performance, does it depend upon the fusion rule? No. It is, I mean, in the asymptotic sense, I mean, so it's without regard to which fusion rule you are using. Okay, so that was one. The first question, so the question, I guess I should repeat it, that does the asymptotic result depend upon the fusion rule being used? And the answer is no. And the first question was how to decide what k should be, I guess. K meaning the number.
K is more than.
K is the number of sensors. And then your question is that L out of K, how to decide L?
No, sir. There are 2^2 K fusion rules.
Okay, so brute force approach will be that you look at each one and say what is the corresponding performance. But that is where Zeno-Shire comes in. That rule will give you one fusion rule that is optimal. So it could lead, it should, or it could lead to one of those L out of K rules with the proper weight. So, I mean, brute force without solving it like we did, it will be take each one and then look what the performance is, but that's not what, that's not a good way to go. So then use the Shire, his work. That gives you the optimum. Okay, one last question before we move on. I couldn't hear you. The concept of what? Centralized detection. What's the first word? Oh, soft decision. Okay, so centralized detection would refer to the fact that you bring all the data in its raw form to a central place. That I would say centralized detection. And soft decision would be that you compress it to some extent. And I guess the thing that I was saying, example likelihood ratio, and then quantize it into 8 levels. So you send 3 bits. For instance, that would be soft decision. So it's more than 1 bit, and then you can go, you can set likelihood ratio, quantized likelihood ratio, or some other statistic, that would be soft decision.
Likewise,
partition
and distribution.
Say that?
Partition and distributed detection.
Hard decision and distributed detection. Hard decision is you're sending zeros and ones, meaning 1 bit, and distributed detection is that architecture where multiple sensors are collaboratively making a decision, a one final decision. That's distributed detection. Okay, so let's stop this here, and then let's see what we can do. Okay, so this part now builds on what we have been doing so far. By the way, this is Latin, in case you were wondering what that is. And don't ask me what it says, science, culture, something, I guess.
What is the last one?
I have no idea, so don't quiz me on that. So, but it is Latin. So, it was, we were established in 1870, so it's an old university. Okay, so now we are moving along to a vulnerabilities and so on, and I thought I had gotten rid of this picture, but it is still there, so I will not talk about this. Now everybody's looking at it. I shouldn't have said that. Okay, so this picture is the same picture that we had seen before, your cognitive radio kind of thing, and There are, at many different places one can try to, there are security threats. So let's talk about this year classification of security threats. There is this CIA model, which doesn't stand for CIA, Central Intelligence Agency, but it is dealing with security threats. So C stands for confidentiality, and in this case, things such as eavesdropping are important. Like that's an example of this. So you want to keep your message confidential, and you don't want somehow eavesdropping to go on. Integrity, and this is what we will be really talking more about. Integrity means that the data that you get across is not tampered with. You get it across without problems. And availability, that you are able to communicate, which means that if there is jamming, somebody puts a lot of electromagnetic energy, then it, the system is not available for communication. So CIA, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Here, there are various aspects where you can tamper with, or one can think about security threats. Cooperative spectrum sensing, which is what we have been discussing in the past lecture, past hour or so. So this is the one that I will spend almost all the time on. So that is your distributed detection or cooperative spectrum sensing, and so integrity will be the part that I'll talk about. I do have a little bit of stuff towards the end of spectrum management, and we will see where we get to that. So spectrum management appears here, and cooperative spectrum sensing, I believe, is here, radio scene analysis, yeah. So that's where these things come in. Channel state estimation and prediction, there could be security threats. Secondary communication, so again, the links, there could be issues. So these I'm not going to talk about. Something that I should say that I thought I didn't have enough material, so I asked my student to add more slides. So in this, there are additional slides in between on eavesdropping and so on, which are not in your notes because they just arrived a few minutes ago, the new material. So I have those in here, and let's see how we are doing on time, because I think I have more material than I can cover, even the eavesdropping stuff. And I asked for eavesdropping stuff because somebody in the room was asking me about eavesdropping and secrecy capacity and all that. I don't know who it was, but there was somebody. So I said, okay, let's bring that in. In case I cover that, then I'll request Professor Jagannathan to make those copies of those slides and give them to you later, not today, obviously, just fresh off the press, it just came. Okay, so that's that. The approaches that one can do, you can design your system under worst case attacks, or you try to employ some mitigation schemes. And what we want to do is computationally simple solutions needed, because what you want is online, fast, rapid things that you need to do. You cannot, the threat is now and you cannot make the decision or do something tomorrow. So it's timeliness is important. And this basically is something that, I just didn't know what to do. Basically, this is more of the neuro side of things, which means that the behavior and beliefs and so on. So this cycle, one can represent that in here, but let me not discuss it. But sensory input, it can be manipulated by the attacker. Beliefs, they can be tampered with, and behavior of humans, for example, it could be malicious or suboptimal. So it basically is saying the same things that I was just saying here, but in a different block diagram, I guess. But it's all malicious actions, changing things, manipulation of things, and so on. Okay, so this one will be the one that I'll spend most of the time on. And this is nothing but the problem that we were just discussing. Distributed detection or cooperative spectrum sensing is a distributed detection problem. So, So on this, there are various types of attacks that one can do. Actually, this must have been added this last night when it was sent, because our focus, this was not there before, only this was here. So anyway, so let's start from here. Primary user emulation attacks. So in this case, what happens is that, I mean, there is a genuine primary user, but somebody starts behaving, well, not behaving, he records the transmissions from here, and then he starts transmitting them so that secondaries might feel that there is, this is the primary. So this person, this node, is emulating a primary user to confuse people, because maybe then if this node starts transmitting the primary user like signal, then secondaries will think that its channel is not available, etc., etc. So it's so this is one type of attack. I will not be covering it. There are some references given at the end. So in case you are interested, you will be able to go and take a look at that. Jamming is something that I guess most of us know what we are talking about. So adding some electromagnetic energy on the communication channels to disrupt communication between the intended parties, as cognitive radio and whatever, the fusion center or something. So this is jamming attack, is at the physical layer. I think somebody here was talking about different layers and so on. So this is actual physical layer that you are adding, you're jamming, you're not letting, or signal to interference noise ratio, you're trying to reduce that interference level up and so on. So that's this part. Eavesdropping. So this student of mine who has helped me making these slides, he likes these things. So you will enjoy seeing this, but he has, is that a crutch and so on? Yeah. Anyway, it's just his humor. Okay, so eavesdropping is that if I'm talking to her, then I don't want others to listen to what we are talking about. So we basically want to keep our message confidential. And so then the question of eavesdropping attack, so it is a passive thing. This person is not really disrupting my communication, but he or she is listening to what I'm talking about, which is not a good thing, because if we are criticizing the third party, then if they hear it, then we are in trouble. And same thing, I mean, I'm on the camera, so and I cannot say anything too controversial, maybe little controversial. So eavesdropping attacks are there, and the problems in this context will be that you want to maximize the information transfer between the intended parties and minimize the information leakage to an eavesdropper. So that's the kind of thing. So we, in my group, we have done some work on it. But a lot of people have worked on it in the information theory community, where they are looking at like Shannon like thing, secrecy capacity, what is achievable, what can an eavesdropper do. And I think Shannon himself, in his papers, he had some results in the early 50s and mid 50s. So eavesdropping has been a problem that has been considered for a long time. But it has become more important with the all this communication that is going on. I guess if you leave a microphone open and then you say something, you pick up, and it is in the media these days. Within seconds, it's on all the, I don't know, whatever social media is. So the rapidity, the speed at which information travels is very scary. Even before I get out of the room, world might know that I said something controversial, I mean, those kinds of things. So eavesdropping is that kind of attack. And this is what we will be talking more about, in which what is happening is that there is a primary user, and that primary user is either using the channel or not using the channel. These secondaries, greens and reds, they are the secondary users, and collectively they want to decide whether the channel is in use or not. Green ones are the honest sensors or the good guys, and red ones are the Byzantine sensors or